How Not to Handle Exceptions, Part 2. In Part 1, we looked at some very simple but very bad anti-patterns, such as swallowing up and hiding the exception as if it never occurred, and simply using DBMS output.putline to display error information. In Part 2, we examined some more complex and challenging anti-patterns. First of all, we take a look at converting an exception to a status code, which is common in some other languages like C, but not a good thing to do in PL SQL. So I've got my procedure that takes in my value and passes back a status code. How did things go? If my value passed in is greater than 100, I'm going to run some code and then, assuming everything completed successfully, set my status to 0. Otherwise, I have a different branch, an exception is raised, and in any case, if anything goes wrong in the program, I'm going to set my status out to my SQL code value, which is 0 if there's no error. Otherwise, is usually, but not always, a negative integer value. I compile my code. And then let's take a look at how I would use this kind of program, this style. Here in my block of code, I call my procedure, pass it 100, get back my status code, and then, after I come back from calling this program, after control is returned, I have to check the status and see if something went wrong. If it's not equal to 0, and I have to know about that magic value, then I need to do something. And now we're back really to the original problem. What do I do? Do I simply raise an exception? Do I write information out to an error log? So it doesn't change the fact that I have to handle the error, but it changes the way I write code to deal with the fact that an error occurred. But let's suppose that the error didn't occur there. I keep going. I call my procedure again with a different value or some other piece of code. And again, after returning from that program call, I have to check the status. And what you'll see is, over and over again throughout the block of code, the executable section, I execute some code, I check the status. I execute some code, I check the status. And I have to check each time to see if I should abort, not continue. This is not a good idea. Let PL SQL handle this for you. Do not convert exceptions into status codes. Instead, let the exception propagate out, automatically terminating the block. You don't have to do that yourself. And then if you need to or want to, you can have an exception section in the outer block and decide what you want to do at that point. But at least you're not checking each time along the way. How am I doing? How am I doing? How am I doing? You end up with way too much code and not a lot to show for it and a lot more complexity and quite likely problems with your code, because if you forget to write this code and forget to include that, then you keep on going even if your procedure might have failed, and that could lead to all sorts of really nasty, hard to diagnose problems. Well, okay then, so you're not going to convert an exception to a status code, and if you watched my previous video, you'll know that you should not simply call dbmsoutput.putline to display error information to the screen. So what should you do instead? You should write your error information out to a table. So let's try that. So here's a very simple error logging table. Generate a sequential ID, the title of the error, whatever general information you want to stick in the log for that error, when it was created, who created it, the call stack, how did I get to this point in my code, the error stack, or error message, and the backtrace, trace back to the line number on which the error was raised. All good stuff. I create my table. Great, so now I can insert into it when an error occurs. Let's take a look. Here's my procedure, pass in my value, I do a bunch of stuff, an error gets raised. Now what do I do? Oh, I'm not just going to call dbmsoutput.putline, I'm going to insert into my log table. I'm going to provide all the values, including making calls to my built-in functions to find out what the call stack is, the error stack, the backtrace. Put it into my table, then I re-raise the exception just like Steven said I should, so I don't swallow up the exception. Let's see what happens. I compile my code. Great. I run my procedure. Oh, it failed with an error. Okay, no problem. I'm going to look in the log and see what happened, see what went wrong. I check my log and what? There's no data. There are no rows in my log table. How is this possible? I inserted, but wait a minute. Oh, then I raised. And when the exception came out unhandled, it automatically performed a rollback, and I lost my error log. Oh, what a drag. So what do I do about that? Well, let's see. How about if I get fancy with save points? So I'm going to say before I start my transaction, so now I've got some code in here, I save the start of my transaction, I execute my DML. If something goes wrong, I roll back to the start of the transaction, I get rid of that information. Then I insert into my log table. I set another save point. Then I raise my exception. Then in my outer block, I can trap the exception, roll back to the error logged save point, and then I can do whatever I'm going to do with my exception, or maybe even commit at this point. The problem is, we can run this and we can play around with it some more, but the problem is, it doesn't really solve the problem. First of all, if we commit at that point, we're committing any changes from before this transaction started, which we might not have wanted to do. Alternatively, if we commit right here, instead of the save point, we can run into the same problem. In other words, I've rolled back this stuff because I just want to save this stuff, but before my procedure was called, there might have been some existing outstanding changes in my transaction, in my session, that I really don't want to save yet because we might still need to be finishing it. So you definitely do want to create an error log table. You definitely do want to write to that table in your exception handler, but you don't want to put the insert statement directly inside the handler itself. As soon as you do that, you're making this insert statement a part of your logical transaction, your business transaction, and you have to manage it along with it. So either you get rid of all of it, or you keep the log in addition to some other changes in your session that you might not have wanted to keep. The solution, which you'll see in How to Handle Exceptions Properly, is to use an autonomous transaction procedure to do all of this work for you. So this is a good idea, doing an insert into the table, calling all these functions to get all that information, but all this code should not appear here. You should be able to just say, log the error, pass in your information, and let the logging procedure do all the hard work for you. And that's what we'll explore in the third video in this series. So to sum up, How Not to Handle Exceptions in Part 2. Do not convert exceptions to status codes. Rely on the default exception handling and trapping mechanism of PLSQL. Second, do not put inserts into your error log table directly inside your exception handlers. Instead, you want to put them into a separate procedure to do all that work for you and reuse that procedure. And in that procedure, you should make it an autonomous transaction to avoid entanglements between the DML required to insert into your log table and the DML you may have executed in your session for your business transactions. Now, in the third installment in this video series, How to Handle Exceptions Properly, I will show you all those specific techniques. Thanks for joining me.